Firstly, thank you very much for the time and congratulations on your new home. It's absolutely spectacular.
Thank you.
So pretty. So, just a little bit of background for my readers. When did you know that you wanted to be a fashion designer?
Sure. When did I know that I wanted to be a fashion designer was in 1993 when I was studying auditing. And I started hanging out with fashion students and art students, and I realized that I actually like being a creative more than anything else. And lo and behold, I visited a fashion class, and the moment I walked in, I knew this was my calling. And dropped out from studying auditing, then went to Vale University to study fashion for 4 years, and I've never turned back.
So you were lost to the accounting world.
Absolutely. Almost the accounting world almost took me over. But, I always say things happen for a reason. 360, I'm finding myself not just being a fashion designer, but being a businessman. And you have to understand numbers. You have to understand costing. You have to understand profitability. You have to understand projections. So I think it was not a loss that I detoured into auditing. I'm actually grateful that I did, because I think my business is becoming better on a daily basis, because I get to understand financing.
As they say, no education is a lost education.
Absolutely.
Did you ever think that you would be one of the most sought after fashion designers in South Africa?
I don't think so. I never thought I would be here today. I never thought that the brand would have grown this much. But all I knew was that I'm called for a purpose. I'm called to be part of this gigantic or enormous industry, which is fashion. And if you asked me when I graduated in 1998 that I'll be sitting here with you, I didn't know. But all I know is that I'm very passionate about the industry. I'm very passionate about creating beautiful clothing, and also changing the mindset of a South African child, saying all you can be is become a doctor, teacher, lawyer, and the typical. So immediately when I graduated, I realized that I have a bigger responsibility to inspire the younger generation, and to inspire the black child, the white child, the Indian child, the colored child, who's sitting at home and just like, I'm a creative, but can this thing that's called fashion be profitable? I had a big responsibility for that. Has it been an easy journey? No, it's been very difficult. Bent so many bridges, bent my fingers, even relationships. Would I ever stop doing what I'm doing? No, I wouldn't. Actually, I feel like now, 18 years later, full-time in the industry and working on the brand on a daily basis is only the beginning of what we've been trying to build as a brand, David Lally. And would I say we've made it or succeeded? I don't know. Success is hard work. That's all I can tell you. And it's just like literally growth on a daily basis.
That is so inspiring, and it's so nice to hear, because like you say, everyone thinks you have to be a doctor or a lawyer to succeed at life. And I think when you say to your parents, oh, I want to be a fashion designer, or I want to be a movie star, they shake their heads at you.
Absolutely. I mean, while you're saying that, when I told my mom that I wanted to be a fashion designer, we fought for like a huge 6 months, because she said, I'm not gonna have a son that's gonna be making clothes. But because I was so resilient, I was so stubborn about my newfound passion, I was like, I'm going to do it with or without your blessing. And years later, she became a number one fan, and which was like fantastic. And I think it's one of those things that, it's a South African thing. It's not like, it's not black or white, it's like, when people or parents think of the creative industry, they don't think it can be a business. Mm. It can be profitable. And you look at amazing people like your Trevor Noah, your Charlize Theron, you look at the likes of Black Coffee, it's all in the creative industry. And it means in the creative industry, we can become the new phenomena of business and professionalism as well.
Definitely. Who is your inspiration?
How much time do you have? My number one inspiration is my mother, bless her soul, who raised four of us single-handedly, and who started from absolutely nothing, and was purely a domestic worker, who then later on became a daycare mother and retired. And I look at the journey, how she made sure that we don't go to sleep without food and with the minimal wage that she was getting, and how she clothed us to school. And because I was raised in a Christian family, and Sunday when we had to go to church, we had to wear Sunday best. And you go to church, you come back, you have a full-on meal, have family lunch. And I think she's been like the best thing that has ever happened in my life, because I look back and I was like, she had so little, but she was able to feed everyone around her and clothe everyone around her. Over and above that, make sure that I'm educated. And but everything, one thing that supersedes everything else that she's ever done was to support me when she started believing in my madness. She was that pillar of strength, and she was that phenomenal woman that made sure that even if she does not have, I would say, the kind of money that I would ask from her, but the love and the prayer life that she instilled in me was more than enough than anything else. It's not about material things, it's about what she meant to me. And today, now that she's gone, I look back, I reflect on her teachings and her principles are the best thing that she has ever given to me. And to say, it don't matter what you do not have, but what you have is love, and give it because you touch people's lives.
Wow. Sure. It's funny how a parent can just like, sure.
Absolutely.
So 2020, wow, what a year, hey? It's been next level. Obviously COVID has happened, Fashion Week didn't happen. Can we still expect a collection from you this year? Is there anything in the pipeline still, maybe? I mean, there's still 3 months left of the year.
Yeah. 2020 has been a very challenging year, and I think it's a year of reflection, redefining, and also finding yourself. Because in the 21st century, we as human beings, we got so caught up in the fast-paced life, where we did not have time to spend time with our loved ones, our families, our children, even our businesses, or even with ourselves, more than anything else. I look at the ripple effects of the pandemic, that it has helped me personally. My spiritual journey has grown immensely. My relationship with my team has grown immensely. And the business side of it. I know many companies have closed down, but we are grateful to God that we have not closed down, we have not even retrenched. We found ourselves actually growing during the pandemic, because the one thing that we had to do as a business, we had a choice to close down, or we had a choice to look within as a business, what do we have? A very simple principle that I've learned with life. In the Bible, there was one woman that lost her husband, who the husband was a servant to the prophet, and then he said, your servant, my husband, has died, and I have nothing to feed my family with, and the taxpayers are coming to take my sons as slaves and stuff like that. And the prophet said to him, what do you have in your house? And she said, I only have a bottle of oil, and he said to her, go and borrow jars from your neighbors and everything else and fill up the jars with oil and sell the oil and pay off your debt, and whatever is remaining, you live off it. When that revelation happened to me, it was the worst time in my business. I was about to say, okay guys, we're done with the mask projects. It's not profitable. Let's just wash our hands and move on. But then I looked inside and was like, God, you've given us an amazing team. You've given us, we've got fabrics, you've given us creativity and ability. And lo and behold, one day I said to the team, today we stop making masks, we're going to start creating collections. We started. How we sold it, I don't know, but we started selling. And we started believing in what we were doing. Thus I say, my spiritual journey has gone to another level, because I learned to trust God even further. I learned to trust my faith and have faith in my faith more than anything else, to say my faith will work. And a few months later, we found the space which was becoming vacant. And we're like, okay guys, in the pandemic, we're gonna have a pop-up store. This is supposed to be a pop-up. And Melrose Arch has been like really fantastic. They're like, okay, fine, come on board. And we did this. While we're busy working on that, like last week Thursday, we just like opened another concept store at Riverville Boutique Hotel in Waterfall. And this is only saying, if you have faith in yourself, if you have faith in God and believe in your madness, anything is possible. In 1 month, we've been very blessed to launch two stores within a period of 4 weeks, and it has been phenomenal. Are you going to see another collection from me? Absolutely. There is a AFI virtual showcase coming through on the first week of November. So definitely we are going to resuscitate, because we are creatives. Do we have the markets? Yes, we do. People have the money. People will always shop. People will always buy. Are we profitable as a business? All I know is that we have the stores. What's going to happen tomorrow? Don't ask. All I know is today we are here. We have stores. I'm doing an interview with you. And all I know is that when God opens a door, he will sustain it or even open bigger doors for you. And I'm saying, during this pandemic, it's time for us as a creative industry, or even the clothing and textile industry in South Africa or in Africa, to look at the opportunities. Number one, we've seen big retailers struggling, closing down and everything else. But as the industry, the emerging talent and as emerging brands, it's time for us to take the opportunity to take these spaces that are becoming vacant and make sure that we can now distribute our locally made products to our customers. Because why? People are not buying, people are not traveling overseas. People are saying, okay, I'm supposed to go to Greece, I'm supposed to go to Paris chasing summer. What do you do with the money that you have? You buy local. That's what it should be.
So you might as well supply local.
Absolutely.
Tell me something. So what do you think about the industry's move towards this transitional collection? Will you follow suit, or are you still going to keep the traditional autumn, winter, summer, spring collection?
I mean, our collections over the years have been season transitional kind of thing, because we have such beautiful weather in South Africa. When we do winter, it's not heavy coats and fur, but pieces that always will, you know, look good during a particular season. Are we going to stick with spring, summer and autumn, winter? Absolutely, because we're not only focusing on South Africa. We're selling in America, we're supplying a store in New York, flying solo, we're supplying in Nigeria, in Ghana. So it's very important to understand your seasons and your collections, because immediately start jumping into the wagon of everybody's like just doing transitional pieces. It's like, where is the fun of it, you know? You still need a heavy winter coat. You still need a super sexy summer blouse for a particular season. So it's very important to stick within your course, stick within your signature as a brand. Do not be swayed away. Like right now, people are like, why don't you make tracksuits? Because people, I'm like, no, I'm not a tracksuit designer. Mm. I'm a high-end designer. We stay on it and we stick on it and people will buy it. Those who can afford it, they're welcome to the shop.
Now, don't veer off, don't fix what's not broken.
Absolutely.
Sort of scenario.
Yeah, because I mean, immediately we start making tracksuits, we look like everybody. Because yep. Everybody's like tracksuit and hoodie. It's like, okay, no, where's luxury there?
I agree.
Yeah.
The Avon David Clarley collection, what an exciting collaboration. Your inspiration behind that?
The inspiration behind the Avon x David Clarley has been like really phenomenal. It's based on the Shibelani collection, which was our spring summer collection 2019-2020, where we fused a lot of movement, a lot of texture. Shibelani is a Tsonga skirt that is worn by women for either for their traditional celebrations or even on a daily basis, they do wear that skirt. That skirt speaks volume because it's handmade, handcrafted. It has over 80 meters of fabric that is hand pleated, and when you see the beads, they are all hand stitched on the bottom of the skirt, and we fused it with an underwater life where we wanted to have a bit of a fluid, almost like kind of tropical exotic elements coming through, but also not trying to be as literal to say this is a Shibelani collection. We're taking elements, we're taking the movements, we're taking the craftsmanship that actually goes into the making of this beautiful skirt. And when we started, developing this collection, I was like quite excited because we started with a captain, sunglasses, a tote bag, a sling bag, and it's been like really, really amazing. And later on, we're like, boom, let's talk about fragrance. And I think that's the next level for us as a brand, that's to say to people, we are tapping into another market. People will say, but David Clarley, you're a luxury brand, why Avon? The answer is, there's power in collaboration. Number two, there's power in distribution, mass distribution, because as David Clarley, the brand, we wouldn't be able to tap into thousands of women or even homes that we actually get into these days. And what perfect timing that this collaboration comes through. Pandemic, David Clarley x Avon is like really fantastic, and I mean people are just loving and just eating this brand every day. And I think it's a new way of doing things. Collaborations are key. Collaborations are powerful because as much as we're tapping into Avon's clientele, Avon is tapping into David Clarley clientele. And ultimately it's just seeing a global brand like Avon, like one of the top beauty companies, believing in a local talent, it's very, very important. Also, it's a stamp of affirmation for us as a brand to say, Avon can trust us with their brand, they can trust us with everything that they do. And I think the timing is actually right for us.
And I think it's also amazing to know that you've now set the tone as a trailblazer in making a luxury brand like your own available and readily accessible to the normal day-to-day woman out there. Because let's be honest, every woman loves a luxury brand,
yeah,
but it's just not always feasible.
Feasible, absolutely.
You know, so now I can also say I have a David Clarley,
absolutely,
and it didn't break the bank.
Absolutely.
You know, so
I mean, it's also like, you know, because as David Clarley the brand, we've always been an aspirational brand, and people are like, I can't afford that David Clarley antelope jacket, but when I tap into Avon, I can get a tote, I can get a sling bag, I can get a caftan, sunglasses, and now I can have even smell almost like David Clarley. How about that?
How amazing. So I always do this when I interview people. I have a couple of fun questions just to bring out that really fun side of you. Which emoji best describes you, and can you show us what that emoji looks like?
It's a black heart, black love.
Black heart.
Every
well, you're
day.
All dressed in heart, wasn't it?
Black heart every day.
Every day.
Yes.
Food that you can't live without.
How many items do you want?
No, oh, your favorite one.
Food I can't live without is chicken curry, fried rice, and Doritos.
Which flavor?
The blue packet.
The blue packet. 3 must-have items if you were stuck on an island.
Island. Sunglasses, Bible, and your boombox.
Okay, what would be playing on that boombox?
Everything that turns you on, everything that makes you celebrate, and everything that transcends you to connect with your spiritual side.
If there was a movie made of your life, who would play you?
Can I have Lenny Kravitz to play me?
For sure.
I mean, how about that? Let's just ask.
American woman. If you had a superpower, what would it be and why?
If I had superpower, I don't think I want it. Because I don't like controlling and changing things that I can't. I'd like to experience life and let life be. Then it becomes much more amazing. Because when you have superpower, you think you're on top of everybody. But that's not life. Okay. It's fabricated.
Almost like Instagram.
Absolutely.
6 people that you could have at dinner, dead or alive, at your dinner table.
My mom, Nelson Mandela, Brenda Fassie, you want 6? Okay. Miriam Makeba, my sister, and if I could be able to take the rest of my team and make them to be one, I would have them.
You know that you're the first person to actually put family members at that table. Whenever I ask this question to anyone, it's always famous people. Mm-hmm. And a study or a video that I watched asked children, and children always say they want their family at the table.
Yes.
And it's quite funny how adults want famous people and children want their family.
So, yeah. Because I think people, like you said, they look at Instagram that this is for the pictures, but you forget that when you break bread with someone, it's about fellowship. It's not about pictures.
It's the people who matter.
On my table, when I host dinner, no phones. Mm. It's all about us breaking bread and making sure that we are present for that particular moment.
Connecting.
Yeah.
Okay, this or that. Chocolate or vanilla?
Chocolate.
Summer or winter?
Winter.
Call or WhatsApp?
Sorry?
To phone or WhatsApp?
Call.
New York or Paris?
I'm gonna play nice.
Apple or Android?
Android.
Netflix or YouTube?
YouTube.
Facebook or Instagram?
Instagram.
Fantastic. David, thank you so much.
Thank you.
I really appreciate this.
Thank you.
We will see you on Saturday, and good luck with the collection and the collection for AFI.
Amazing. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.